Welcome to another episode of the True Crime Tales. Today's episode is called The Death of Annie Kasprzak, a case with the most insane twist you've ever heard. Annie Kasprzak entered the world on January 10th, 1997, into an environment devoid of the stability and nurturing care most children are entitled to. By the tender age of 7, Annie had already faced the heartache of being returned to state care 5 times. Yet, amidst this turbulence, a ray of hope emerged in the form of Veronica Kasprzak, a caseworker with Utah's Division of Children and Family Services. Veronica's connection with Annie was instantaneous, transcending the usual boundaries of caseworker and client. This bond was shared by Veronica's then-husband, Dennis, who also became an integral part of Annie's transformative journey. Despite the challenges that followed, including the eventual divorce of Veronica and Dennis, they provided a foundation of love and stability for Annie, a beacon of hope that guided her through the storms of her past. Annie had dreams of becoming a therapist. She was drawn to the idea of helping others, perhaps influenced by her own experiences and the compassionate environment she was raised in. This period of relative stability and nurturing, however, was tragically cut short. Annie's life took a significant turn when she formed a relationship with Darwin Christopher Bagshaw. Their initially thrilling and unpredictable teenage romance transformed into a difficult situation following the announcement that many parents fear. Annie said she was pregnant. On March 10, 2012, 15-year-old Annie was at home babysitting her brothers while her adoptive parents went out for dinner. Veronica recalls that upon their return, everything appeared normal, with Annie having changed her attire from shorts to jeans, which Veronica attributed to a possible change in temperature. Veronica, experiencing a severe headache, decided to take a shower. Meanwhile, Annie retreated to her bedroom to listen to music. It seemed like a typical Saturday evening. However, when Veronica emerged from her shower, she discovered that Annie was not in the house. Annie's stepfather, James Bratcher, inspected her bedroom and found a note hidden under her blanket. The note began with an apology from Annie, expressing regret for not being completely honest. P was a lie, and California was going to be Annie's new home. The note said, "I am sorry, Mom, I made a mistake. I lied to you about a couple of things, and I am sorry, but I have to leave. It's not you, it's me. By the time you read this note, I'll be on my way to California. I lied to my friends. I told them I was P, but I only wanted their sympathy. That's why I lied. I feel out of place here, and my only way out is to run away. Please don't try and look for me, because I don't want to be found. Love you guys, but I have to go now. Bye." P was short for pregnant. Shocked by this discovery, Veronica immediately contacted Draper authorities and reached out to Chris in hopes of finding her daughter. The next day, a jogger would discover a single, red bloody shoe near the Jordan River. Soon after, about 1 mile north of where the shoe was seen, Annie's body would be found. The signs of a violent attack were unmistakable. Annie had suffered a brutal beating. As the investigation into Annie's murder unfolded, it was mired in confusion and false leads, complicating the search for the truth. The initial theory of her being a runaway was quickly overshadowed by the horrifying realization that they were now searching for her killer. At the beginning of the investigation, Annie's boyfriend, Chris Bagshaw, was a key figure under scrutiny. During a police interview, which his father, Darwin Leroy Bagshaw, attended in accordance with Utah law for minors, Chris discussed his relationship with Annie. He mentioned last seeing her on the Wednesday or Thursday before she went missing, a fact that later became an important piece of the overall investigation. During the interview, Chris appeared tense and distant, suggesting there might be more to the story than he was sharing. He explained that a nosebleed incident involving Annie accounted for the presence of her blood on his shoes. However, this explanation raised suspicions. The situation became more questionable when investigators found messages from Chris to a friend, Spencer, asking him to support the nosebleed story. This suggested that Chris might have been trying to mislead the investigation. Spencer backed up Chris Bagshaw's account of Annie's nosebleed. He told investigators that he was at the gym with his brother the night Annie was killed, suggesting an alibi for himself. Furthermore, on his phone, detectives found a video of Spencer, Annie, and Chris just weeks before the murder. This video showed Annie flashing what appeared to be a gang sign, leading to questions about her possible gang connections. However, upon closer examination of Spencer's initial interview with the police, Jacqueline Moore, the lead detective on the case, discovered something damning. Spencer was texting throughout the interview, and at one point, a detective asked to see his phone. The text messages revealed that Spencer was not only texting girls, but also communicating with Chris about the story he was supposed to tell. Specifically, Chris had texted Spencer to say that the police took his shoes, and he needed Spencer to tell them that Annie had a bloody nose, as it had dripped on his shoe. This evidence suggested that Spencer had been asked to lie to corroborate Chris's version of events, indicating potential collusion in the aftermath of Annie's murder. Initially, Chris Bagshaw, the main suspect in the case, mentioned LJ as a potential threat to both himself and Annie. He alleged that LJ had threatened to beat him up and that Annie had considered running away with LJ. This mention of LJ led detectives to investigate the possibility of his involvement in the case. Spencer Criddle further complicated matters by telling police that LJ had hacked into Annie's computer and threatened Chris. Even one of Annie's teachers recalled her complaining about her computer being hacked, which added credibility to the claim. However, as the investigation progressed, the existence and role of LJ in the case became increasingly dubious. Detectives were unable to find any substantial evidence of LJ's existence or involvement. When pressed, Annie's friends admitted that none of them had ever seen LJ. The theory that LJ was a significant figure in the case eventually revealed that he was more of a fabricated or exaggerated character rather than a genuine suspect in Annie's murder. This false lead involving LJ cost the investigators valuable time and resources, ultimately leading them back to focus on Chris Bagshaw as the primary suspect. Chris's grandmother, Wilma Fernbackle, was an important figure in the story about Chris's location on the night of Annie's murder. The family stated that Chris was at his grandmother's house all night. However, phone records showed several calls from Wilma to Chris late into the night, contradicting this claim. Wilma's insistence that she only made one call that night, along with her apparent failure to remember the other calls, raised suspicions about a possible deliberate attempt to hide the truth. Further inconsistencies emerged when call records indicated a late-night call from Chris to Wilma at 12:47 a.m., contradicting Darwin Leroy Bagshaw's statement of seeing his son asleep around 11:30 p.m. These conflicting accounts hinted at a potential family effort to protect Chris, possibly fueled by fear or loyalty. The investigation took a confusing turn with the involvement of Joanna Franklin. Franklin, who was struggling with drug addiction at the time, claimed to have witnessed Annie's murder and offered this information in exchange for immunity from her own legal issues. Joanna also provided a physical description of LJ, noting that he was shorter than her, appeared to be Hispanic, but had a complexion that resembled a white person, and was approximately 19 years old. However, Joanna's behavior during the interview raised doubts about her reliability. She was described as overly animated, with intense eye contact and pressured speech, all of which could be indicative of substance use or mental health issues. Furthermore, her consistent reference to Annie as that girl, rather than by her name, added to the concerns regarding her credibility. Franklin accused Daniel Robert Ferry, an associate of hers, of committing the crime. She provided a detailed and violent account of how Ferry allegedly propositioned Annie for sex, and upon being refused, attacked Annie, leading to her death. The police, familiar with Ferry's criminal background, found Joanna's story plausible and arrested Ferry. Daniel Robert Lehigh Ferry's involvement initially painted a grim picture. Ferry, a 31-year-old with a checkered past, found himself wrapped up in the investigation following Joanna Franklin's accusation. Franklin claimed to have seen Ferry physically assault Kasprzak after she refused his sexual advances, leading to a horrifying sequence of events where she was allegedly beaten, wrapped in a tarp, and taken to the Jordan River Parkway. Franklin's accusation, while compelling, was based on the account of a single witness. Ferry maintained his innocence. "I'm a lot of things. I'm a gang member. I'm a drug addict. I'm a drug dealer. But one thing I'm not is a child killer." The case against Ferry, however, began to unravel as the investigation progressed. Crucial evidence and alibis emerged, disassociating him from the crime scene and the time of Kasprzak's murder. On March 6, 2013, Draper City Police announced that Daniel Ferry was no longer considered a person of interest in Annie Kasprzak's death, clearing his name of the crime he had been accused of committing. Annie Kasprzak's family, unknowingly and inadvertently, provided an alibi for Christopher Bagshaw when they reported her as a runaway. By labeling her as a runaway, her family implied that she had left home of her own volition. This assumption suggested that Annie might have willingly met with Bagshaw. The family's initial characterization of Annie as a runaway diverted attention from the possibility of foul play and, in doing so, allowed the focus to shift away from Bagshaw momentarily. Derek Johnson, the lead investigator in the case, was a seasoned detective who initially worked closely with Jacqueline Moore. Moore had joined the detective division with enthusiasm, excited to work alongside Johnson, whom she trained with at the police academy. Their partnership, however, was short-lived. Johnson was soon promoted to sergeant and moved out of the investigations division, leaving Moore, with only 6 months of experience in the department, to lead the investigation as the sole detective on the case. Despite feeling overwhelmed and alone in her pursuit of justice, Jacqueline grew more determined than ever. Tragically, Derek Johnson's career and life were cut short in a violent incident. While finishing up his patrol shift, he stopped to check on what he thought was a stranded motorist. This seemingly routine act turned fatal when the male ambushed him and began firing, resulting in Johnson's death. The loss of Johnson was not only a blow to the police department, but also deeply affected Jacqueline Moore, who had regarded him as her only ally and connection to the case. Yet, this personal and professional loss only seemed to strengthen her resolve to find justice for Annie. Moore sought out specialized training to enhance her understanding and analysis of cell phone data. Initially, investigators had found the cell phone activity of both Chris and Annie to be erratic on the night of the murder, with their phones pinging rapidly between several cell towers. This unusual activity had previously led investigators to conclude that it was impossible to accurately determine their locations on the night of the murder. However, with her new training and expertise, Moore was able to uncover a critical insight. She discovered that the reason for the rapid cell phone pings was due to poor cell signal connection, causing their phones to connect with multiple towers in quick succession. Moore and her instructor found that there was only one location in the region where such cell phone behavior could be replicated, the crime scene. This indicated that both Chris and Annie were in the same place at the same time on the night of the murder, contradicting Chris Bagshaw's previous statements and alibi. This evidence significantly strengthened the case against Bagshaw, leading Jacqueline Moore closer to solving the tragic murder of Annie Kasprzak. In October 2014, the investigation into Annie Kasprzak's tragic murder took a significant turn with the arrest of her boyfriend, Chris Bagshaw. For 2 years, her death had deeply affected the community, with law enforcement initially following different leads. When Chris was apprehended in Colorado, the focus of the investigation shifted drastically. Facing first-degree murder and obstruction of justice charges, his initial plea of not guilty heralded a grueling legal battle. A breakthrough came when an inmate at the juvenile detention center, where Chris was held, shared a harrowing account. Chris had confided in him, revealing information about the murder that were both detailed and disturbing. The inmate's account, laced with the reality of the crime, resonated with the cold facts of the case. This revelation was consistent with the findings of Annie's autopsy, as confirmed by a state medical expert, bridging crucial gaps in the investigation. Chris's direct connection to the murder became undeniable. In a stunning turn of events, Chris's guilty plea a week before the trial in February 2016 brought an abrupt end to the legal proceedings. The tragic murder of Annie Kasprzak indeed stemmed from a deeply flawed and disturbing motive, intricately linked to the false belief that she was pregnant with Chris Bagshaw's child. Annie had told Chris and her friends about this supposed pregnancy. This misconception played a pivotal role in the sequence of events leading to her untimely death. Bagshaw, under the false impression that Annie was pregnant, orchestrated a meeting near the Jordan River, disguising his sinister intentions under the guise of a romantic gesture. Chris's decision to lure Annie to this secluded spot was calculated, a far cry from the romantic notion it may have initially seemed. In a brutal act of violence, he attacked her with a shovel he found at the scene, causing fatal injuries that led to her death. The attack was marked by extreme violence, including severe beating. This method of murder confirms the heinous nature of his actions. The motive behind this appalling crime stemmed from Chris's erroneous belief in Annie's pregnancy with his child. His thought process was irrationally geared towards eliminating not just Annie, but also the fictional problem of the non-existent pregnancy. This irrational logic reveals a deeply flawed reasoning where the value of human life was tragically disregarded over a fabricated dilemma. The conclusion of the legal process in the murder case of Annie Kasprzak brought a measure of finality to a long and painful ordeal, particularly for Annie's family. Chris Bagshaw, who was only 14 years old at the time he committed the crime, was tried and sentenced as an adult, reflecting the severity of his actions. By the time of his sentencing, Chris had turned 18, and the court, acknowledging the gravity of the crime, handed down a substantial sentence of 15 years to life in prison. He was slated for eligibility for parole in 2034, indicating a significant portion of his life would be spent behind bars. Darwin said in court, "I'm very sorry for everything that happened. I want to apologize to Annie's family." The defense argued for a lesser sentence earlier by saying he was high on drugs and snapped upon learning of the pregnancy. This case highlighted the complexities inherent in teenage relationships, where emotions can run high and decisions are often made without full consideration of their consequences. The devastating outcome of Chris and Annie's relationship served as a stark reminder of how quickly situations can escalate when fueled by intense emotions and poor judgment. The extreme behavior exhibited by Chris Bagshaw at such a young age raised critical considerations about the psychological and emotional development of adolescents. It brought to the forefront discussions about how young individuals process and react to challenging situations, and the importance of guidance and support in helping them navigate these formative years. The defense agreed that Bagshaw needed to be punished, but said, as a 14-year-old who committed the crime, not as an adult. The defense called for 5 years to life instead of 15 years to life. The defense called Dr. Davies, a witness, to talk about Bagshaw's age and brain development at the time of the crime. He said he never evaluated Bagshaw. Adolescents are emotionally driven. They do stupid things, Davy said. Prosecutors said the event was PLN-ed and said the victim even pleaded for her life, but was told to shut up and Bagshaw still delivered the fatal blow. Dennis Kasprzak, the victim's father, said when he identified his daughter, what he saw was not his daughter, but something you might see hit by a train. He said she wasn't hit by a shover, but repeated hits over and over. Her lips were split, and her nose was gone. He pointed at Bagshaw during sentencing and spoke to him directly. You know what you did. The victim's stepmother, Jennifer Kasprzak, took the stand and said that during the period when the murder wasn't solved, Bagshaw could have come forward to say he killed her but didn't. Dennis Kasprzak made the same point and that for 2 years Bagshaw never came forward. Jennifer Kasprzak said a day doesn't go by when she doesn't yearn for Annie. I want her back, she said. He not only took her life, but he also took all of our lives. The world lost an angel, Dennis Kasprzak said. I lost an angel. Veronica Kasprzak, Annie's mother, also took the stand and read from the victim's journal with a list of 25 reasons she liked herself. She said she never forgot Annie and the night Bagshaw decided his future was better than hers. Kasprzak's family said in 2014 that Bagshaw and Kasprzak were together for about a year and a half. In March 2012, Kasprzak's body was found in the Jordan River in Draper. Investigators say she had been beaten to death. A terrible crime deserves a serious sentence, the judge said, and he handed down the 15 years to life sentence. Stay tuned again next week for another episode of the True Crime Tales. Be safe and see you again next time.